Very first episode of the 2017-2018 season, and we are very excited to have you guys back with us. I am Cameron Che. To my right, I have Bo Hendrickson.
It's the most wonderful time of the year.
Bo, Christmas is a few months away, but we have in front of us Eddie Murad. Say hello, Eddie.
I'm already double-fisting.
He's also drinking beer. So, what is to come in this episode? Well, we have injuries, telling you guys what happened in the offseason as well as the preseason with some of your favorite players, as well as some of the Kings. We have 2016-2017 and 2017-2018 ranking comparisons, which is basically where we believe each team will fall in their respective divisions at the end of the year. Then we have ups and downs, a new section that we are going to have just as this first episode to see where two particular teams are going to end up compared to last season and the reasons why. So are they going to go up or are they going to go down? Keep listening to find out.
Ask Katy Perry.
Oh. Up there, down, and yes,
spoiler alert, Katy Perry is a really good hockey analyst as well.
She'll be up in a few minutes here.
That's how I prepare for this podcast. Just listen to Katy Perry all day.
Well, when we're not listening to Katy Perry, we are doing mock drafts, and that's what we are going to bring you guys today. That was a terrible transition. I'm sorry. But that's going to be it for our episode. Next week, or later in the week, we are going to be having some additional things in another episode, like sleepers, my buddies,
my
news,
buddies!
and more. Yeah, it is. News and more. So stay tuned for that. We'll have several episodes pumped out this week and then continue with our weekly schedule. So without further ado, let's get started with injuries.
I think we should kind of bring up one thing here. So as Cam mentioned, Eddie is over here double fisting, and there's a reason why. I think to kind of put the lay of the land of where we're at right now and how Mr. Edward is feeling, he should kind of dive a little deeper into what's going
yes,
on.
Yes, Eddie, let's hear what happened today.
My fantasy team in football. Cue the sad music because it's making me depressed right now. I'm supposed to be excited for fantasy hockey, guys. This is the most exciting time of the year. And, oh, God, football's just got to bring me down.
That's why we don't play football. We play hockey.
Yeah, precisely. So, you know.
His fire does not work. Katy Perry firework. Never mind. Okay.
Do you ever feel, guys, like a plastic bag floating through the wind?
With a hole in it?
Into a third world country.
Down.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it feels awful. Kudos to Andy in our league of record. Pounded me today.
But what else happened today?
Well, I did probably over, I want to say over 30 hours of research for this podcast, and it all due to technical difficulties with Macintosh computer. So
we've reached out to
Go Android.
Yeah. Go. We've reached out to Apple tech support, and it'll be a couple months. So
they said
we've looked to other geniuses.
They have some things to discuss.
All right, well, as unfortunate as that is, we are dedicated to getting this info to you guys. So we are going to continue with our episode, and Eddie will power through and give you guys the best advice for his ability. But
you got
injuries,
it,
guys.
John
Let's
Scott,
get
number
going.
One overall, baby.
That's heard it here first.
That's what my notes say.
Episode over, all right. injuries. Why don't, Bo, why don't you get us started over here?
Okay, I can do some injuries here. Let's start off, we'll look at the Kings right now. This one, obviously, nothing new here. Marion Gabrick, he is out, as always, and will forever be. He underwent knee surgery on April 24th, so you can already tell that he was hurt going into the season, and it's going to be a bummer for him because he's not going to be ready for training camp.
Oh, geez, Gabrick.
Yeah, so knowing him, this recovery process is going to be a long and a strenuous one, so don't expect him back. I wouldn't even consider drafting him at this point. Just kind of wait and feel that out to see if he's going to even be fully healthy, because who knows with him. Next up, we have Zach Parise. This is more of a minor injury. They said he tweaked his back, but is expected to return to practice on Friday, which was last Friday, and I believe he did. So see him to be ready for the season opener. No worries there. Another one we got is Andrew Shaw. So Andrew Shaw, you know, Maple Leafs fourth liner, he is dealing with some concussion-like symptoms, which is never good. But then he got clearance from the doctors, and they're like, oh, yeah, you know, he doesn't have any concussion problems, but he does have a neck injury, which could also be much worse. So ouch. Right now they have him down day-to-day. We'll kind of see. It has possible long-term injuries that could linger the whole season, so keep an eye on him. Ryan Ellis is next up. I'm sure you've heard about this one, but he had off-season knee surgery after the Stanley Cup.
Oh, after his breakout season, too.
Yeah, he had a great season, so that's too a bummer bad. To hear. But the initial prognosis is that this type of knee injury will keep him out 4 to 6 months after the injury, so that they are long? Expecting him to miss most of the season.
Really?
I mean, it's already been...
that long.
Well, it's what is it?
Ended in June. It's been like two-ish months.
Yeah.
Did he get Dustin Browned? What happened?
I think it was something during the playoffs.
Oh my God.
I mean, Dustin Brown could have appeared on the Penguins. You never know. He's a secret agent on any team.
I took a Dustin to the knee.
You're out. You're out. It's 4 to 6 months.
That's a really old reference.
Don't come back
to
work.
So for those who didn't catch that one, we're a little bitter over here. Dustin Brown taking out Thomas Hurdle a couple years ago and forever ruining his career. So.
Yep.
We hate that guy.
He was going to be the next Sidney Crosby, you know?
Dustin Brown?
Yeah. And then all of a sudden, he just ruined his career by knee-to-kneeing people. And, you know, that's how it goes sometimes.
It unfortunately happens. But another injury, this is not as much. I mean, it's kind of it's bad all overall, but that's Brian Boyle. Diagnosed with a chronic myeloid leukemia. Did I say that right? Is that good?
Yeah.
Oh, beautiful. Devils are hoping. I mean, this is serious. Any type of cancer is gonna hurt you and your longevity in general.
Mm-hmm.
So they were expecting him to be out a little bit, but now the Devils are saying that this won't cause him to miss much time. We can see how serious it is. If it's more of like a season long, like he might be in and out of the lineup. You never really know with something like that. So
almost like a Brian Bickle type situation. But
yeah.
I mean, yeah. I hope this Brian gets healthy soon too, you know.
Yeah, that'd be great. He's had.
Brian Bickle had
I don't know
MS,
if you guys have been.
What?
Brian Bickle had MS.
He did. Wait, which
is cancer, right?
Yeah. I'm just saying, it just sucks that we got two Bryans in there.
I know. Don't be named Brian in the NHL.
Yeah,
it'll hurt your career. But the amazing thing with this, I don't know if you guys saw, but a lot of old teammates, just fellow NHL players, ended up reaching out to him.
That's good.
And sending tweets saying like, "I hope you recover. Mm-hmm. You know, I hope you're doing well." And you know that. That more than anything can motivate someone to make a return.
It's all about
the
mindset.
Yeah, so hopefully, you know, that helps him going forward.
We wish the best for Brian Boyle here at the Puck Buddies podcast.
We do.
As well.
Good luck, Double Bs.
Yeah.
Double Bs.
Change your first name. Maybe you'll get better.
Yeah. It could help.
Brian.
All right. Another major Devils
injury
here is their number one center, Travis Zajac. On August 17th, he underwent pectoral surgery. Oof. And they told him he would miss 4 to 6 months. So, you know, that'll keep him out for a while. So they are expecting him to be back sometime in between December and February. We'll see how that goes. But that'll hurt a Devils team that needs him desperately at center.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the next one, I got three Ottawa Senators for you. It's not looking too good with the injuries they have. Clark MacArthur, he's always been dealing with injuries. He's been out for a while, missed most of last season, but he failed his medical exam and wasn't cleared to participate in training camp. So who really knows what could happen to him? His chances of playing are looking slim at this moment. Derek Brassard, their number one center, had shoulder surgery. Yeah, you know, they sent him off to war.
Oh,
they're like, you took a couple too many shots, like Bubba Gump got shot in the butt. and then they did a little surgery, and they're hoping to have him back for the season opener. And they're definitely going to need him, because this next injury they have, Erik Karlsson, is going to be the killer of the Ottawa Senators. He had surgery and to repair a torn tendon in his left foot.
Dude, he was playing on that in the playoffs and still smoking people.
Yeah.
He's unbelievable.
He's an unreal player. One of the best, if not the best defenseman in the
I think he's the best
in the NHL.
Yeah.
So that is going to definitely hurt a team like the Ottawa Senators. So
and watch out for that in your fantasy drafts too.
Especially because he's still going in the second and third round sometimes. So,
but if he goes low enough, he's a steal, you know.
But at the same time, be weary because the Senators have made it clear that they are not going to rush his return. So I don't know what exactly that means. It could translate to as much as 15 to 20 games if his ankle isn't progressing quickly. He said he was ahead of schedule, but the players literally always say that when they're interviewed. So.
Players always say that because they want to play. The coaches always say they'll save them just to, you know, make sure that they're not.
But at this point, I really don't know where they stand. So that's just something to keep in mind as well. If you have your fourth or fifth overall pick, I don't know about that.
Yeah. I would totally take him with my third or fourth pick. And
you mean no, third rounder? He's staying first round.
I'm saying
the
fourth or fifth overall pick.
Oh, overall pick.
Absolutely not.
No, I wouldn't do that. But it all depends on how they start the season. If they start out and they're doing well and they get points, they can let them rest.
Yeah, if they can stay above water without him until he comes back, that's going to be real, real powerful.
But that team runs on Carlson.
Yeah,
so
we'll talk about that a little more into the episode. I'm going to let you know how I feel about them then.
Okay.
So next up, we got a Penguin that was injured during the Stanley Cup playoffs. That was Patrick Hornquist, which is kind of crazy. He has a broken finger, and he actually was playing on that broken finger when he scored the game-winning goal to win the Stanley Cup.
Must have felt really good.
So he
instantly
healed
for like an hour.
So that'll definitely, you know, feel good in the moment, but he had to have surgery during the offseason. He's skating now. They're not sure if he's going to start the season, so just kind of monitor how he is. But he's a great player on the Penguins, so definitely worth a fantasy add, but don't take him too early with the injury. Next up, we got a couple of Blues here. This is kind of good, pretty bad for the Blues. We'll start with Robbie Fabbri. As you know, he tore his ACL last season, and he came back and played his first preseason game last Friday, and afterwards he said he felt pretty good. Well, you know what, guys? Obviously, his word does not mean much. Because it has just been said that he will sit out the rest of training camp after re-injuring his surgically repaired left knee.
Oh, no.
So who really knows what that could mean? Any re-injury is a bad injury. So we're definitely going to have to monitor him, kind of see what they're doing with him, if they even let him skate or not. So
his poor wife.
Yeah, for now, Robbie Fabbri, keep your eye out on him. Next two were even bigger blows. Alexander Steen and Jay Bomeister hurt themselves in the exact same preseason game.
Nice.
So against the Dallas Stars.
One of their two best players.
Yeah. Against the Dallas Stars, Steen ended up injuring his hand, and he'll be out at least 3 weeks, and he's going to begin the season on the IR. So he might be a good pickup to just throw on your IR if you have an IR spot. And Jay Bomeister fractured his left ankle. So they don't know how long that's going to take. They're going to reevaluate him in 3 weeks, and then we'll see how it goes from there. Okay, next I got I'll give you two minor injuries and one major one. This first one really hits close to home. But Bo Horvat, he had a minor upper body injury against the Kings in China.
China.
But luckily they expect him back for the season opener, so won't sweat it too hard. Go, Bo. You'll be fine. Next up, Brian Little. They said he's a little banged up.
But he's probably worse because his name is Brian.
Yeah, but they won't give us any more details than that, so consider him day-to-day. And finally, James Neal underwent hand surgery after the Stanley Cup playoffs, has yet to skate, and they're saying right now he's planning to be a little bit behind schedule. So that's going to hurt an already Las Vegas team that, you know, doesn't have too much star power, and he's supposed to be the big goal scorer on their team. So they need him back as soon as they can, but we'll see. All right, Eddie, you want to go through the rest of the injuries?
I'm going to go a little quicker through the rest of these. We just got a few more. We have a minor injury with Patrick Eves, just a lower body injury, not related to his ankle that kept him out during playoffs. We have Ryan Kesler, that's a huge one.
Mm-hmm.
Hip surgery on June 17th. Bob Murray hopes to have him back by Christmas, so keep that in mind when you're drafting. Hampus Lindholm, another major surgery, his shoulder surgery over the summer. and he should be back early November. And Sami Vatanen, another major injury, shoulder again, and he's expected to play sometime in November as well. So the Ducks are extremely hindered this in the start of the season, so just keep that in mind.
Yeah, we'll kind of talk about that a little more when we're discussing Anaheim and their rankings.
Right, and OEL, Oliver Ekman-Larsson, just got injured in the last preseason game versus the Sharks on Saturday. The severity is unknown right now, but we'll just keep that monitored.
We'll update you guys, yeah, as the week goes on.
Yeah, and then we got Torrey Krug and Matthew Tkachuk, both minor injuries. Torrey Krug took the puck to the face. Holy crap.
Like an animal.
Yeah. Just like a beast. He's just like,
like a
coach. He actually tried to bite the puck while it was tipped at him. Lost a couple of teeth, but he's still okay.
Ding. Yeah. Coach sure tried to emulate that too. Didn't work too well for him.
Kuch got hit in the face again with the puck.
Did he?
Yeah, but he turned his head at the last second and hit him at the bottom of the neck, or the top of the neck, I mean, as opposed to the teeth. But it was going right for his mouth. I watched the video of it. It was crazy.
Oh, man.
That boy just better replace his whole jaw right now.
Swear cage.
Wear a cage. Thank you.
Yeah, or that. But let's see. So Matthew Tkachuk, minor hip injury, participated in full, should return soon. He's a big asset to the Calgary Flames, so that's good. Marian Hossa will be out the whole season. Very, very major. He had a rare progressive skin disorder. I'm not trying to laugh, but I was just like, that's so random.
Out of nowhere.
Yeah. And the side effects of his medication are preventing him from playing. He's unable to wear his equipment. Oh, my God. A major allergic reaction. That's crazy. That's
feel so bad
terrible.
For him.
That's going to be a big blow to the Chicago Blackhawks. He's their third best scorer. Huge veteran on the team and adds a lot of depth and, you know, a lot of leadership. So that's a big blow to the Blackhawks.
That's going to hurt a team that already has huge salary cap issues.
Yeah.
And to just hold on to a player that can't even play is going to hurt them in the near future.
Give him to Philly.
Give him to Philly.
Because Pronger in there. Sorry.
Hi.
Hang out with Pronger on the long-term IR.
Seriously. And still get paid for like 17 years. Mm-hmm. Anyway, we got Boone Jenner and Brandon Dubinsky on the Blue Jackets out.
The big bruisers.
Yeah, Boone's out with a minor undisclosed middle body injury, considered day-to-day. And Dubinsky underwent wrist surgery. There's no timetable for his return. But they're just waiting for him to become 100%. Martin Hansel, Justin Abdelkader, and Zetterberg and Cronwall are all out. Hansel had a minor injury on his ankle, and he should be ready for the season opener. A bunch of Red Wings are out. Abdelkader had a groin injury. Zetterberg had a kink in his neck, but he should be fine. Cronwall has been having back spasms. He's had a history of that, so I'd pretty much avoid him. He might be retiring soon.
Yeah.
Happens when you lay out so many people in your entire
with your back.
The wall can only stay up so long, you know.
It has a couple cracks now.
Did Mexico pay for that one? Or?
Detroit Red Wings, tear down this Cronwall. Anyway, and the last but not least, we have Vincent Trocheck, huge player in Florida who had a down year, but he still had a great year. But he had a minor injury, sustained a upper body on Tuesday, and we just consider him day-to-day for now. Injury's not suspected to be serious, but he took part in practice on Friday, so expect him to be back for the season.
Alrighty, well, that does it for injuries. The next section we're going to move into is going to be our ranking comparisons from last season to this season. So I'm going to open it up with one of our divisions here. Which one do you guys want to start with?
Start from the first
Atlantic?
One. Yeah, let's start with the Atlantic. I think that will be a good starting point.
Okay. So I'm just going to quickly go over where each team fell in the Atlantic as of last season. And then we will go into where we believe things will change for this season. So last year at the top, we had Montreal with 47 wins, 26 losses, and 9 OT losses for a total of 103 points. Next was Ottawa with 44 wins, 28 losses, 10 overtime losses for 98 points. Closely behind in third, we had Boston with 44 wins, 31 losses, 7 OT losses at 95 points. To go for the rest a little bit quicker, we had Toronto at 95 points, tied
39
with Boston.
Points? Yeah, oh, man, they're up there.
Toronto at 95, Tampa Bay in fifth with 94, Florida Panthers at sixth with 81 points. Detroit in seventh with 79 points. And then Buffalo right behind them at 78 points. So with this Atlantic division as of last year, what changes do you guys see for this season? Do you project for this season?
I see the young guns taking over in this division.
Yep. Are we talking Toronto here?
Talking a little bit Buffalo. Of Toronto Maple Leafs. Yeah, Buffalo moving up. A little bit of Tampa Bay Lightning. Yeah.
Okay, so let me hear, Bo, let me hear your top three for
top
the Atlantic.
Top three?
Yeah.
So I know a lot of people are riding high on this Maple Leafs team. There's, you know, they're pretty high up there with their young guns. They're got the great coach. They got a great GM, and they're just making all the right moves at this time. But I actually do not have them at number one.
Ooh.
I have the Tampa Bay Lightning at number one with good reason behind it.
As do I.
Yeah. Eddie's there right with me. I don't know, Cam, you might have something else to say about it.
I do.
But the Lightning are just, you know, they have the star power already. I know they have some up-and-coming players too, but Kucherov, he's at this point becoming one of the top five players in the NHL. Stamkos is, you know, after that season-ending injury last year, he's finally back, and I think he can still produce. But more than anything, you know, Andrei Vasilevskiy proved that he can be a full-time NHL starting goaltender. So I think that he can hold it down, and Lightning could take first. The Maple Leafs will come up right after them because they are going to be either number two or number one. And I have the Bruins falling behind them just because I can't get over that Marchamp, Bergeron, and Pasta line right there.
Pasta might not be signed this year, though.
They signed him.
They
signed
him.
That's
smart.
They
signed him.
Yeah, he got paid.
Eddie, what about you? Let me see your top three.
Mine's very similar. I have Tampa Bay and Toronto fighting for the top two.
Okay.
I have Boston dropping a little bit, but I also didn't realize they signed Pasta. So I might have him at them at three.
So you have the top three of the same teams?
Pretty much. Buffalo I have sneaking in there, though, really high up. They came. They were in last year in this division, but I definitely see them pulling ahead in at least the middle of the pack or even into a playoff position.
Okay.
At the bottom of the league, I have Florida and Detroit for sure bottom.
I think we all do.
Yeah.
I think the whole league does
and
at this point.
I don't know. I think I have Montreal very, very low compared to a lot of people. Even with Price, they're I don't know. The decisions they make in Montreal are just not conducive to like a winning record. Yeah. They don't like make a team that is flows right or meshes right. But Drouin was a really good add. I just don't know if they're all going to mesh well together, and we'll see though. I mean, they got talent.
In their preseason games so far, they've looked pretty good.
Okay.
And I'm excited to see if Schlemke will play with Weber.
If that happens,
well,
I highly doubt he will. But he's a good puck moving defenseman, and Weber's got the shot. So I mean,
that's why I think they will try them together. I'm calling it right now. I think that they are going to have some playing time together, and I think if they mesh, that could be a very, very dangerous pair. I think Schlemke is going to bring some good jump to the second power play unit. So I have them fourth, the Canadiens. My top three are Leafs, Lightning, and then Senators.
Okay.
I know they have a lot of injuries, but I believe that they're going to be able to, like I said, stay above water until Carlson's back. Mm-hmm. And then I believe he's going to drive play towards the end of the season, and they're going to finish really strong. So those are my three for the Atlantic. You guys can let us know what you believe.
One thing I want to mention about Montreal that I actually took note of that is relevant here is they were 30th last year with 81.1 shots attempts per 60 on the power play, and this all has to do with the power play, and that's a huge part of having success in the regular season. Radulov was a huge part of that, and they're replacing Radulov with Drouin in the top six on the power play. And Drouin helped the power play of the Tampa Bay Lightning by increasing their shot attempts per 60 on the power play by 8.75. Radulov helped their power play in Montreal by 11.39. So just the fact that the player they're replacing their star with is not as good as him or hasn't been known to do as well, I think that in itself will show that their power play won't do as well since they were 30th last year, and they're not getting any better on that. And their number one centers are a little iffy. They're still trying to decide whether Galchenyuk will be in the center or on the wing, and it seems like he's better on the wing.
He's not going to be center this year. I'm almost positive.
He shouldn't, but
he hasn't earned it. But I actually think Drouin is a much better two-way player. So while the penalty, or the power play, I mean, might take a little bit of a hit for shot attempts, I think adding Schlemko to the second power play unit will increase that number. And I think Drouin is a better two-way player than Radulov was. Radulov had a lot of offensive boost, but he was kind of terrible defensively. So yeah.
Well, the point was that they're not getting enough offense.
Yeah.
So that's the problem. Because Price can only handle so much. He needs the support. And
yeah.
I mean, he stands on his head every game.
Oh yeah.
And they still
unless they play the Sharks for that first time.
And their rookies get all the
game. Yeah.
Yeah, that was sweet. But that's just something I was worried about. That's why I have them so low, is like they're not improving like their team where I thought they should.
Okay.
But anyway.
Yeah. We'll see how that how that pans out. Mm-hmm. Let's move on to the Metro. If you guys wouldn't mind,
let me talk
about where the rankings were last year at the very end of the season. In first place, we had the Capitals with 55 wins, 19 losses, and only 8 overtime losses for a total of 118 points. That's ridiculous. Next, we had Pittsburgh, who had 50 wins, 21 losses, and 11 overtime losses for 111 points. And in third, we had Columbus with 50 wins, 24 losses, and 8 overtime losses. I have no opinion about Pittsburgh or Columbus. You can totally tell by my voice. They had 108 points. Columbus did in third place. The rest of the teams, a little bit quicker here. We had in fourth the Rangers at 102. We had the New York Islanders in fifth place with 94 points. In sixth, Philadelphia with 88 points. In seventh, Carolina with 87. And last but not least, we had New Jersey with 70 points. Eddie, let's start with you for the Metro. Who are your top three?
Okay, for the Metro, I have Pittsburgh at the top, reluctantly. But there's no denying how good they are.
Mm-hmm.
And then I have Washington coming in slightly below,
mm-hmm.
Then Philadelphia, and then Columbus.
Yes!
New Jersey and Carolina, Rangers and Islanders. And I have the Rangers super low this year. And
Lundqvist is getting old.
He's getting old. Their team didn't change except for Shattenkirk. But Shattenkirk can't carry a team, as we saw last year in the playoffs. So he is the one of the best defensemen for the power play. Like, unreal on the power play.
Mm-hmm.
So that helps them a lot, but it just...
Is that enough, is your question?
I don't think that's enough. And this is a very young... The teams are getting younger, they're getting faster, and the Rangers are still staying the same. So I think it's going to be interesting to see. They have a couple young players like Buchnevich and Vesey.
Vesey.
Mm-hmm. And he's on the top line, maybe, with Nash or something. But we'll see. It depends on health. Depends on Lundqvist's health.
Also depends on Nash.
Nash's health.
What?
Zibanejad's health.
Yeah.
Zibanejad's supposed to be their number one center now with Stepan gone. So,
yeah.
You know, I like Stepan a lot. Arizona's going to be number one in the Pacific. No, just kidding. That's a total joke. But yeah, my biggest upgrade here, though, is Philadelphia and New Jersey, though.
I noticed that. Can you explain a little bit for those two?
Yeah, so the Flyers, I think, will be going up because they have a lot of young talent.
Mm-hmm.
They had a down year with Gostisbehere.
Yeah,
he was benched a couple of games, which was ridiculous. But I think he'll have a bounce back year. That was his sophomore year. Their power play from 2011 to 2015 was ranked third. So that was like where they want to get to again.
Mm-hmm.
And now that Giroux's healthy, Voracek's going to be on his line being healthy. Gostisbehere is going to have his bounce back year, I think. And
I
now they have Nolan Patrick there as
their young
center.
Mm-hmm.
Young player. He's going to be great in the top nine role. They have Oscar Lindbom, fifth round pick, fourth in scoring the Swedish Hockey League. He's going to add some depth. Their D-man is looking pretty decent. And the biggest upgrade to me is Brian Elliott. They got rid of Mason. Brian Elliott, a lot of people are down on him from Calgary. Calgary is a very interesting team because they're very offensively based, and Philadelphia is too, but I think they're much better on defense. So that's going to be a huge upgrade for them. I think Yeah, the Flyers will be great. And then the Devils, I think, will be better because of their number one draft pick, getting Eberle. Mm-hmm. Hall will be there, and I think he'll be starting really well. Their only question is on defense, but Schneider's down for a bounce back year as well because his numbers are just outstanding, and he had one bad year. So.
And I think Mirko Mueller's going to have a big year, because the Sharks will never allow him to get NHL playing time.
Sure, right.
And I know that some people laugh about it, but I actually think that if we didn't have a sixth defenseman, he would have jumped up in front of DeMello. He has a much higher ceiling. So I'm excited to see what he'll do with the season, with the opportunity given to him.
Mm-hmm.
He could become a big player for them. So hopefully for him, that happens.
We'll see. He still has to crack the starting lineup. Mm-hmm. As of now, they don't have him in.
I think he'll get about 30 to 40 games this season is my guess.
If anything, he's their young prospect too.
Yeah.
So they want to refine him.
Well, it's like kind of a make or break year for him. He's at the age where he needs to break the lineup either this year or next year. Because even though defensemen kind of peak a little bit later, he's what, 23 now? So.
Yeah. That's true.
Anyway, Bo, did you have your picks
for the Metro? I'm not going to go through all of them. I'm just going to kind of talk about the ones that I might have different than maybe not exactly the same as Eddie. So I know this is going to be a big one, at least with you, Cam, but I do not have the Hurricanes that high. I mean, do you see more upside than I do with their team? I know they're young.
I think a little bit later, after this section, I'll talk about the Canes.
I'll let you
bit.
defend yourself there, but
yeah,
I do not see them that high.
I want to hear your opinion.
But I see them still being young. I mean, Darlene will help, but we still don't know if he can handle the starting load. He has been a backup his whole career, so to make that jump will be huge. Luckily, he will have Ward there, which could help. But I've seen better starting lineups across the Metropolitan in general. I was kind of fighting this one, the Islanders and the Hurricanes. I don't see them either as well, but I didn't think a team with John Tavares on it could be that low. They're going to be bad, but they're not going to, be close to the top.
The Islanders were like, hold my beer.
The New York Tavareses.
But the main thing, pointing out here is I know we're all kind of feel the same, but the Capitals are going to be falling a little more than we would expect. I mean, Eddie has them kind of high.
Yeah.
I think me and Cam are a little more around the wild card range. But that's just mainly to all the losses that they suffered this season. A lot of good players left. Like they couldn't, like you said, they couldn't do with Shattenkirk. I think, did they lose Orlov too?
Orlov's still there, but they lost. I'm going to describe it as well, but just to give you a really quick thing, the key losses for Washington: Johansson, Shattenkirk, Williams, Alzner, and Schmidt. That's a huge, huge list of five names.
Yeah, so we'll
good
go.
Demon.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we'll go back to them a little bit later. Cam will give you some solid insight there. But more than anything, we all expect Penguins to have dominance. I think for me, I do have the Rangers a little higher. That's just me thinking that I know they lost more players, but their defense is still, in my opinion, one of the more solid units in the league. Just having Brady Skjei and Brandon Smith as their
Brady
Skjei, Skjei.
I always say Skjei.
But having them as their third pairing, I feel like is pretty solid. So I can work with that, and they're still strong down the middle with Zibanejad, Hayes, and Miller. Those are three solid centers, so I'm cool with that.
Mm-hmm.
So if you guys are fine, let's move on to the Western Conference.
Yeah, all of mine were very similar. Only thing is I had the Jackets and the Rangers switch because I love the Jackets. So
I just want to hear your Carolina argument.
Yeah,
you'll hear that. Don't
well,
worry.
Let's get through the last two divisions, and then I will start the ups and downs with my Carolina argument. I think you guys will concede a little bit to my picks. Okay, so let's go on to the Central. The number one in the Central was Chicago. They had 50 wins, 23 losses, 9 overtime losses with 109 points. Number two, we had Minnesota, 49 wins, 25 losses, 8 overtime losses with 106 points. Then we had St. Louis in third place with 46 wins, 29 losses, 8 overtime losses at 99 points. The rest of them, a little bit quicker. Number four, we had Nashville with 94 points. Winnipeg in fifth place with 87 points. Number six, Dallas at 79 points. And last place, Colorado with 48 points. Are you kidding me? We are equal opportunity teams here. So, yeah, yeah. They started out
just like that
slow and got really slow. So let me do my really quick for my central.
Wait, before you do that, can we all agree on one thing?
Yes.
Who's going to be last?
In the central?
Blackhawks, right?
I hope so.
I actually put them on a different page. That's how low they are. No, I'm kidding.
No, yes. The Avs will be the worst team in the central, if not in the entire NHL.
Yeah, I'm surprised if they aren't.
I'm curious to see what you guys think of my top three for my central picks. So I have the Stars.
Yep.
Winning that division.
Woohoo.
Followed by the Preds, followed closely by the Hawks. I want to hear your guys' thoughts.
I just have the Hawks and the Preds switched.
Switched? Okay.
So I'm a little different. I mean, I have the Hawks as my number one just purely because they're the Hawks. I mean, if you want more analysis than that, just look at the history
go watch
of
the, last
of the
10
Central.
Years.
Yeah, yeah. And how the Hawks have been these past couple of years. Just tough to doubt them at that point, but I can totally see them dropping with the cap situation they're in, the amount of rookies they have. But as long as you have Kane and Taze on your team, I won't doubt you. The other
they got Saad back, right?
I think the only difference the other name that I have in there that I don't know if either of you have is the Minnesota Wild.
No, I was dropping.
I have them like third to last.
Yeah,
that's exactly where I have them.
That could just be overall. Yeah, throw those high fives, those fist bumps. It's cool. I'll be on.
Yeah.
I'll just be going wild Woo! By myself over here.
Ow.
But I am just a fan of the depth they have. I mean, when your top three centers are
didn't help them last year in playoffs.
It helped them get to the playoffs. So that's what I'm ranking. I'm not ranking for whatever's happened in the playoffs.
They
I'm
had
just
a lot
ranking
of nice
for
bounces go
for
way.
Them making it to the playoffs, but. With Stahl, Granlund center, and even you can throw Koivu as your third center. That is a strong depth down the middle right there. So I'm cool with that. Their
they have
defense,
a lot of Pokemon on their team.
Got to catch them all, and they obviously have.
Koivu.
You've ran into a wild Minnesota.
Parise.
Oh, Parise got injured.
Parise.
Forever paralyzed.
Parisealized.
But the main thing here, I feel like, with the Minnesota Wild is Devan Dubnyk. If he can play how he's been playing these past couple of years, then that's how I see them as number two in the division. If not, I will be right there with you guys.
Fair enough. Let's go on to the last and most exciting division, the specific division. So, last season, number one was Anaheim.
Boo.
46 wins, 23 losses, I mean, 13 overtime losses for a total of 105 points. Second place, Edmonton. They had 47 wins, 26 losses, and 9 overtime losses for a total of 103 points. Bringing up third place here, we had the San Jose Sharks at 46 wins, 29 losses, and 7 overtime losses for a total of 99 points. The last four here, and remember this is not including the Vegas Knights because they are new this season. We had fourth place Calgary at 94 points, fifth place Los Angeles at 86 points, sixth place Arizona with 70 points, and last place Vancouver with 69 points.
Nice.
Now, let's hear, Eddie, let's hear your rankings for the specific division.
Well, I'm kind of biased, of course. I have Sharks as number one.
Do you?
No.
Okay.
Edmonton for sure has to be the Ducks or the Oilers for me. And I'm taking the Oilers right now because they beefed up their squad exponentially with some of the acquisitions they made. But also, Anaheim has so many injuries right now. So they're not going to start off very hot. And I don't know if they can.
Might.
Yeah. Anaheim or the Oilers are going to just be, you know, on fire the whole season.
That's the exact same reasoning I had. That was,
so, yeah. Edmonton will be first. Anaheim might be second or third. I have the Sharks right below them because I love them. And then I have the Flames climbing up there, too. And then the Kings I have next. Arizona and the Kings might be interchangeable for me just because Arizona made a lot of great offseason changes.
Step on.
And then the Knights and then Vancouver are just going to stay down there in
the last.
Same.
Yeah. Even
started
I literally
from the
got
bottom
the
and we're still at
list.
The bottom.
Really?
Yeah.
We did not corroborate on that either, so that's interesting.
You guys had exactly the same?
We had literally exactly the same.
Wow.
Oh, dang.
All right, Bo. Try to...
make
us a diverse group.
Yeah.
I'll try my best. The main thing I think with me in the Pacific is Sorry, that was a good one. The main thing with me in the Pacific is I was trying not to be as much of a homer. I mean, I love the Sharks, and I will always think they're the best team in the NHL, no matter how many times I'm wrong, and I'm choking on those words.
Just like the Sharks.
Yes, exactly why I've said
that. I got you now.
But I will agree, the Oilers will be at the top. I was thinking the Ducks, but those injuries, you can't overcome them. But my main team that I think is going to move up higher than we all would think would be the Calgary Flames. Mm-hmm. The moves that they made this offseason are, you know, one of the best.
Mike Smith.
They got, you know, that decor that they've been working on is even better at this point. They got, I know they picked up Hamonic. They got rid of Brian Elliott, and we'll do you wonders right there. even though Mike Smith, you know, he's not the best goalie in the world, but if he faces 40 shots, then he will be the best goalie in the world, seeing that he hasn't lost a single game in regulation with 40 shots.
Or more.
But just their defense is pretty solid. You know, that top pairing, Mark Giordano, Dougie Hamilton, is going to do great for them. And I just think that I can see them moving up a little more. Bounce back season from Johnny Gaudreau, Sean Monahan, Matthew Tkachuk is going to be a great player that gets under everyone's skin. So I could see a little better out of them, possibly a number three, if not top wild card spot.
Awesome. Well, that does it for our rankings as far as each team. Now, I want to move into our brand new section to finish this part of the first episode. This is called Ups and Downs. What we are doing with the Ups and Downs is we each will talk about two teams, one that we believe is going to go up for various reasons, and another that is going to go down. So I'll begin. I know you guys want to hear my Carolina reasoning. So
let's hear it.
I want to know.
Will you tell me? Okay, so last season, I'll repeat what they had. They had 36 wins, 31 losses, and 15 overtime losses for a total of 87 points. Not terrible. They were in a very tough division. Mm-hmm. So if they were in the Pacific, they still wouldn't have made it, but they would have been way closer above the Kings, etc. So let's look at who Carolina added and who they lost. I'll begin with who they lost. All of them are okay. Well, yes, but
another Brian.
Who they got rid of in the offseason. Eddie Lack. Eddie who? No one cares. He was lacking in everything. Ryan Murphy.
Poor Eddie.
Still don't care that much about Ryan Murphy. And then Andre Nestor still. So those three are really the only major losses to this Carolina team. But let's talk about the additions. Justin Williams, Mr. Game 7, all right, is joining the roster as the third line winger and kind of quarterback of the second power play. So that is going to boost them quite significantly, I believe. They have Scott Darling, and I'll talk a little bit more about him in a moment. Marcus Kruger, and then Trevor Van Riemsdyk. So they've got some pretty significant additions, I believe, on all fronts. Now, one big if you could say for this team is what Victor Rask is going to do this season. He is currently their number one center. Should he be? I don't know. He got over 50 points last season. Can he do that again? I believe he has the potential to reach 60 plus points. And with Justin Williams there to bring some life to the second power play, I believe they're going to be just fine. However, they are a very defensively minded team. Almost all of their forwards are two-way forwards as opposed to pure scorers. What I foresee happening, you guys are probably going to disagree, Matt Duchesne's going to go to Carolina.
Ooh.
Carolina has four or five unbelievably talented up-and-coming defensive defensemen in the pipeline. Colorado needs defensemen. They need people to boost their defense.
They need everything.
I believe Matt Duchesne, because he does not want to be with Colorado and is really, really butting heads with Joe Sakic, the GM, I think that he already has requested a trade multiple times. I believe this is a good location and is a win-win for both sides.
Yep.
So I could see that happening before the trade deadline and Carolina making a push for that last wild card spot. What could go wrong? Only thing I foresee, besides injuries, specifically to Jeff Skinner, who has had multiple concussions over the past couple years, which is a little bit concerning, The only thing for me that's more concerning is if Scott Darling can't handle a full 60 to 66 game season. If he cannot, the Canes have absolutely no chance of making the playoffs because Cam Ward is way past his prime. However, if Scott Darling can take on that full starter role, I believe they're going to make the playoffs. I don't know what you guys think, but
I like the Duchesne tank or take right there. That
yeah.
So
I like it. I agree with the Darling.
It's kind of all on his shoulders, which sucks. Yeah. But
I want to give you one more name. But the person that I think is going to have the biggest season on the Carolina Hurricanes is Sebastian Aho. Yeah, I think he's going to probably be one of their top point producers. Obviously, Skinner's going to be up there. If he's not number one, then I say Aho's going to be the number one right there for them. So,
yeah, luckily Aho doesn't have a history of serious injuries, so that's a good sign. But Skinner at this point does, so that worries me a little bit. But I think the Carolina has it in them.
They do,
and they have a lot of talented young defensemen as well.
Yeah,
so.
For sure. I was going to mention Noah Hanifin. He was a great prospect coming out, and he's playing with Falk this season, so that's going to be a great 1-2
Falk,
punch
yeah.
right there. And then even proving it last year, Jakub Slavin, he played some solid hockey throughout the end of the season, and he proved that, you know, he can handle those minutes. So expect him to be a little better. And this pickup they just got from the Blackhawks, or actually they got the Blackhawks. He was taken in the draft by the Vegas Knights and then was traded to the Carolina Hurricanes, and that's Trevor Van Riemsdyk. So they were talking great things about him, and you know, the Hurricanes went out and got him, and there's a reason why.
So. Cool. Well, Eddie, why don't we do your – do you have a team that you think is specifically going to be a fairly large jump upward?
So I'm going to pick the New Jersey Devils this time because they were just so bad last year. A lot of it was just not having the support Schneider needed and him having an off season. So big questions for this team this year is Schneider rebounding, Nico Hersher's impact, the number one draft pick this year. Yeah, and then getting more goal support. Those are the three things that I think are going to be the biggest question marks. Also, replacing Travis Zajac since he just got injured, that's a huge...
I heard Marcus Johansson might take his centering spot
for
the first couple of games.
Yeah, he's a big... It's a big blow taking him out, especially because he's 54.7% in faceoffs, and that's, you know, that makes a huge difference in the NHL. And but supposedly they want to do Henrik, Hersher, and Johansson. One of those guys will be on the top line center, so we'll see. It just depends. All those guys are capable. I think Hersher will need to get accustomed to the speed and the longevity of the NHL first, but he's a very, very talented player, so I'm sure he's up to the task, so we'll see. Over the past three seasons, the New Jersey Devils have had shot attempts, or the shot attempt percentage at a very low number. They're 27th in the NHL at for their shot attempts, which that doesn't help Corey Schneider at all. So we're just...
Sorry, that was just funny.
Why?
I don't know.
Okay. But, you know, I think with a lot of their additions to the offense, they should be able to get more offense going. Schneider's rebound should be on track. He's been working on his workout regimen. They hired a new goalie coach, Roland Mellison, and he worked with Schneider in Vancouver, and that's how he became so, you know, so rock solid in his fundamentals. So I think having him back, they purposely went to get him because he's so comfortable with him. And so I personally expect a rebound from Schneider. He's a stellar goalie, one of the best in the league. The Devils have made a point of making them better on offense. My biggest thing is defense, but they don't have a lot of offensive talent on defense. Like Severson's their best defensive offensive defenseman, but they should be able to score a lot more with their center lineups being a little more stacked. And then when Zajac gets back, they will be
then they should be
solid.
Much better. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, they let's just hope. Need him back. They need that number one center badly.
Yeah, let's hope whoever takes that spot can hold it down for
Long John Johansson.
Yes, he's back.
All right, Bo, what's your team?
So my progression candidate is probably the most obvious one out of both of your guys's. I think everyone and their mom saw this coming. But the Dallas Stars are going to be moving way up the Central, and with good reason, too. They've probably made some of the, in my opinion, some of the best off-season moves, getting Alexander Radulov to play with Sen and Bagan, or Bagan, Sagan. Combine Ben and Sagan, you combine them together, they're just banging. But yeah, that's probably my favorite line in the NHL right now. I can see them putting up so many points. I know, you know, you're going to say, oh, well, Ken Hitchcock is there, and he's a defensive-minded coach. Well, you know what? When you have that many great offensive players, you got to let them play. Like, you'll teach them to play a bit of the two-way game, but you can't hold them back from that type of potential. But I would say my main reason that I'm so high on the Dallas Stars right now is their depth down the middle. They got Sagan as their first-line center, Spezza as their second line, and Martin Hansel as their third line. And up-and-coming Devin Shore as their fourth, if you want to go that deep. But just right there, if you're so strong down the middle, that can win you so many games as is. So with that being the case, they picked up Mathod over the offseason, and he's going to shore up that defensive pairings right there, being number one with Klingberger right there, the burger. And the most important pickup of all time is Ben Bishop.
Oh, yeah.
That right there is going to give the Dallas Stars something they haven't had since Marty Turco, and that's an elite starting goaltender. So I can see that just making them moving up within their division and, you know, putting more numbers to what we saw not last year but the year before. So see the Stars making major moves in the Central this season. So if you guys don't mind, let's go on to some regression candidates.
Let's yeah, let's just quickly go through this real quick. I'll do mine because it's really obvious, and I don't think anyone has any argument as to why it would be the other way around.
No way, Jose.
Because my pick is Washington, who won the President's Trophy. Literally the only way they can go is stay the same or down. So the reason that I believe that they're going to go... they have to get to the third round first. I'm so sorry, Washington fans. That was really mean. The Sharks choke way worse than you guys. However...
Stanley Cup final.
The key additions, and I say key with gigantic quotation marks around
major
it.
Major key.
Because there's only one addition, and it's Devontae Smith-Pelly. And he was a free agent signing. He's a big body, plays, you know, fourth line minutes. It's whatever. Key losses here. We're talking about Marcus Johansson, Kevin Shattenkirk, Justin Williams, Carl Alsner, and Nate Schmidt. All of whom are no longer with the team. So after years of playoff woes, it seems as though the Caps' chances of making it past round two of the playoffs has begun to dwindle. There is, however, one potential positive. Jakub Vrana, who was the 13th overall pick in 2014, could take Johansson's spot on the second line, but there is a lot resting on his shoulders to keep the Caps' playoff hopes in sight. And as Eddie pointed out with other players, he really has to get used to a full 82-game NHL season. I don't know if he's going to be able to do that, but that's kind of the only upside that Washington has right now for going farther in the playoffs.
Yeah,
I just don't see that happening.
Ron, I've heard great things about him as well. He's definitely going to be getting those top 6 minutes to start. He's going to have to learn, you know, the defensive side more than anything because we know he has the offensive talent.
Yeah.
But he's going to be playing with great playmakers either between Kuznetsov or Backstrom. So there's definitely upside there. Mm-hmm. So I can see it there as well. All right. Well, I'll hop into my regression candidate. I'm interested to hear your guys' take because this is probably more of me just seeing things a little differently, but that's not saying that they could go the other way. But that's the Ottawa Senators. The main thing with me is they were number two in the Atlantic Division, so I see that being tough to replicate, especially when you have some injury concerns with first and foremost Erik Karlsson. If he does not come back soon and come back at 100%, the Senators are just completely screwed. There's nothing to go past that. He's the best player on their team, possibly even the best player in that division. So Erik Karlsson is injured. Their number one center, Derek Brassard, they're hoping he'll be back for the season opener. But you know, until you know, you can't really, you know, make that decision that they're gonna be that great. And then also, I know they played without him last year, but Clark MacArthur, he showed a lot of promise during the playoffs until he was out. But he is still a solid player for them. If he doesn't play, that's going to hurt them more than help them. But they've done it without him before, so that's completely possible. But my main reason for Ottawa Senators having a regression is the other teams within their division. As we mentioned before, the Lightning and the Leafs, we all see them as top contenders in that division. And then between the Bruins with, you know, Marchand, Pasta, that dominant first line of last season, and just the Canadians purely leaning on Carey Price, I expect both those teams to make playoffs, which will make it hard for the Sens to fight for a wild card spot. Mm-hmm. So it's gonna be a battle between the Canadians and the Sens, and probably the Bruins for one of those spots. But that's why I see them going a little lower than usual. But as Cam mentioned before, this is really key. If they cannot start fast without Carlson, then I don't think they can start or finish well at all either.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, for mine, I'm going to pick controversial pick, I suppose. Uh-oh. But picking the Wild going down.
Ooh.
And this pick is based on just the fact that they did so well last year and their numbers are unsustainable. But just because they fall in the standings doesn't mean I think they'll miss playoffs. I think that they'll actually do better in playoffs this year if they make it. And the reason why is because they gave Dubnyk, who was a stellar goalie, just a really huge workload. And they needed to win some games, but I think a big key this year will be keeping him fresh for playoffs. That'll be a huge deal. Also keeping just their lines in general fresh for playoffs. Mm. They got a depth player with Eriksson Ek. He's very, very talented, but he's 20 years old.
What the heck?
And with the loss of Hanzel and Halla, it's kind of hit both their offense and their defense, both. But Hanzel is a great two-way player. He's a huge PK, a special teams guy. And so that's a big hit to them. But mm-hmm. Eriksson Ek should grow into a great center, capable of being in the top six. He will be in the third line center probably this year. So it's not as much depth as they had last year. But the other thing is Bruce Boudreau is one of the best coaches in the NHL. He's usually, I think he's one of the best. When he coaches, he adds an extra 9.8 points to the teams he's coaching in the standings.
What?
Which is one of the best in the NHL. It's pretty good. That doesn't translate to playoffs sometimes, just because.
Yeah, but still, that's an awesome number. Yeah.
It's a great number to have, and so.
Especially when you coach the Ducks in the Wild.
Yeah, so I don't know. I just think they're due for a little bit of a regression, but that's not a bad thing in this case.
Right.
But I just don't think you should expect them to be at the top of the league like they were last year and just dominating everybody.
Yeah. I agree.
Yeah. That's all I got for that.
Oh. Cool. Well, anything else you guys want to say before we wrap up this part of the episode?
No, we're excited for the season. Mm-hmm. This is going to be a great time here at the Puck Buddy Podcast. We hope you guys continue to listen to us. We're going to have some great insight throughout the whole season, and we're going to have a lot of fun more than anything. You guys excited?
Hell yeah.
Are you asking me or the audience?
Oh, I was hoping to hear the audience, but since we're the only three people in this room, I was hoping you guys would say something too.
All right, well, stay tuned, guys. We will have these episodes out to you as quickly as we can and get on a more regular basis as soon as the season starts. So good luck. Unless you're in our league, then good luck to us. Okay.
Yeah, get ready for the My Buddies episode. It's coming soon.
He's coming.
My buddy, my pal.